secondhand smoke. There's nothing I can do or change what I must face, even though I've never lit, puffed, or took a drag from a cigarette. I too have to deal with everyday pain and suffering as though I've smoked all my life. As a child, seeing the painful death of both of my parents, that's one hard pill to swallow. Now, I'm faced with having to deal with what I must encounter as a teen. Oh, how I wish this was all just a dream. But it's not. Cancer lives and breathes within my body. And now, I'm stuck with my inheritance. I guess we all were fooled. I'm Kenneth Roundtree, and today would have been my 21st birthday. If my story can convince you to stop smoking, then maybe this will.
You're listening to My Father's House, I Win Internet Radio Station, the King's Highway for the heart, mind, body, and soul, serving the greater Las Vegas and surrounding areas.
Torn all apart. their old familiar carols play. And mild and sweet their songs repeat, of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And the bells are ringing like a choir. In despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said, for hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth.
Here's the U.S. National Weather Forecast. Rain and snow showers and gusty wind for the northeastern U.S. with snow for much of western New England. Dry and chilly for the mid-Atlantic states into the southeast with a few showers for Florida. Some snow showers for the Great Lakes and the northern plains. Further south, we have a large storm system moving through the southern plains.
Prepare yourself, for the word of the Lord is coming forth. Listen to it. It's coming straight from the word of God to you.
Praise the Lord. We worship you, Lord, this morning. We welcome you into this place, Lord God. We bless you, Lord, with everything, Lord God. in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Welcome to my Father's House Church this morning. Hallelujah. Today is, what are we doing?
Well, we're going to have a taste of where you're from. It's a luncheon that we're going to have immediately after service right in our buffet fellowship hall area. And for those of you who brought something, thank you for bringing something. And what it is, ladies and gentlemen, congregation, brothers and sisters, is food that you grew up with, something that's native to your culture, or maybe it was a favorite dish that your parents made or that you came up with, that you're bringing to share with the congregation so all of us can chow down and have a good time and fellowship. Hallelujah. All right.
Praise the Lord. Any visitors here this morning? Hallelujah. Well, praise God. We do have Daryl and Lenora Beck from Kingman, and we have you from Kingman, but they're here visiting today because they're picking up kids and daughter and everything, so praise God. So welcome to my Father's House Church, and do you have any other announcements?
Yes, two other announcements. Does everyone know when Christmas is?
Yeah.
I'm just checking. Okay, all right. Anyway, we're having a Christmas Eve service December the 24th at 6 p.m., so please come. Let's worship the Lord. Let's get fired up for Christmas season. And, of course, on the 25th, the next day, we're having a Christmas morning service, which will probably be our normal Sunday morning service. So we want to invite you back to continue the celebration of the Christmas holidays.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Yes, you can wear your pajamas. Just kidding. Not. So praise the Lord. If I could have the ushers go ahead and come on up here, and I'm going to also have Miss Sally come up here. Sally blessed me yesterday. Come on, Sally. Hallelujah. This is a blessing. You know, the Word of God says to not despise small beginnings, to despise our beginnings. Amen? So this is a testimony. Okay, and tell them about the 100.
I'm not going to say the amount because this is a blessing.
Pastor had mentioned before that she collects her change and puts them in a bucket, and every time she picks it up, she says, "Thank you, God, for the blessing." So I started doing that 2 years ago, picking every penny I found, and I needed money this week, and I'm like, "Let me take this money." My husband said, "It's only gonna be like $30. I said, "But that's gas." Uh-huh. So when I took it in, it was $122. And pennies that I just found. Yeah. So that, and I was like, "Okay, now what?" So now I told that to other people, and they all went and bought piggy banks and started doing it.
But what she was doing was thanking the Lord for her business, and God's increased her business. And she was thanking the Lord every time. And all that $122 was money she just found that people kind of throw away, you know, and money she found. And then we got really blessed yesterday because as she was leaving, because Sally comes and cleans my house. If you guys ever need your house cleaned, she's awesome. So that's her business. And what happened is we were getting ready to leave, and our neighbor is moving. And she saw Sally, and she said, "Hey, I have a dish set. I got all kinds of coloring books, everything. Does she want it?" And Sally said, "Oh, yeah, I'll take it. Hallelujah." So God, yeah, she had a whole bunch of stuff to give to children, to the kids. And then she had a new dish set to take home. Is that awesome? So praise God. So, Father, I thank you for the small beginnings, Lord God, that when we tithe and we are in covenant with you, Lord God, you bless us, Lord. And you even said that you'll bless us abundantly, Lord God, and open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that we don't even have room to receive, Lord God. That what happens is we begin to receive and we begin to give away, Lord God, because of how faithful you are to us, Lord God. And we want to be faithful to you. So we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Everyone said amen. Amen. So praise God. Thank you, Sally. Hallelujah. So hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I love Sally. She loves to go into homes, and when she does, she's praying through the home at the same time. And she's raising up two little twins from someone that she cleans their house, so they trust her. And she said, "Well, can I teach them about Jesus?" And they said, "Sure." And how old are they now? Four? They're 4 years old. Praise the Lord. So they're learning about Jesus. So welcome to my Father's house again, and welcome, Internet Church. We just welcome you into the presence of the Lord, and we, hallelujah, the servant of the Lord, Pastor Jose Boveda. Go ahead. I love your shoes.
How you guys doing? These are my Christmas shoes. Somebody said that they would scare the devil. So you got, get with it. Get with the Christmas, deal. Every man should have one. Hallelujah. Have the support of the women. Not one man has said anything. Well, I have to tell you something. There was a lot of jokes about when they saw me walk in with the shoes, but the best joke came from a Puerto Rican. And I don't know if I should say this, but I'm going to. I'm from Cuba, and she looked down and she says, "Are you wearing those because Fidel Castro died? Are you celebrating?" And I said, "No." No. But anyway, you can never tell what what's going to happen around here. Oh, my gosh. That one threw me for the loop. Okay, we've been talking about the three, and the way that we normally mention those are the three temptations of Christ. That's how they're known among the Christian world. But what they really are the three rebukes to the devil. And we've been on this, and we covered the first verse, which is Nehemiah. And a lot of times, the power does not come from, screaming loud, although I've been known to do it. It doesn't come from all kinds of different things, but it comes from what is inside the person. What is inside of you is what determines the level of your authority. And we found out that in Nehemiah 2:10, it says, when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the servant, the Ammonite, heard of it, they heard something, it grieved them. So they heard this and it grieved them. What did they hear? And they heard of it, it grieved them exceedingly, a lot, that there was come a man to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. If a person is not seeking the welfare of God's people, okay, you shouldn't even get up to bat. The devil's already won. You're already whooped. Jesus cared for the people. And it's just an amazing thing what he did at the cross, beyond amazing. But through history, there have been men and women that have gone to a place or been in a position where they were looking for the welfare of others. If you do not, if this scripture is not your foundation on everything that you do for God, the devil will just laugh at you. He might even pinch your cheek and say you're cute. But as far as having authority to set anybody but free, or you yourself being free, don't kid yourself. For God so loved, or God so cared for the world, that he gave his only begotten son. So the number one thing that we have to have nailed down pat is the welfare of others. No greater love has any what? Man, that he should lay down his, that's caring about somebody what? Somebody else. So we took a whole Sunday and ministered on that. You're going to be able to get these series and so forth. Then we covered the part where Jesus, and we'll go over it briefly, and Jesus being full of the Holy Ghost returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. So it was the Spirit of God that led Jesus to the wilderness. The children of Israel were led of God out of Egypt into what? The wilderness. To conquer the wilderness. Whatever situation you're dealing with, you are there to conquer that wilderness. If you do not conquer the wilderness, you'll never enter into the promised land. Did you understand that? There was a work that had to be done in the children of Israel before they moved into the promised land. If you just end up getting a truckload of God's blessings and the wilderness is not driven out of you, if you have not conquered your own wilderness, you will fall. I believe that that's one of the explanations why you see, some Christians, you really see them on fire for God, they get saved and so forth, and then you have the parable of what? Of the sower. Okay, I don't know if you've ever noticed. But the one that fell on certain ground, and the ground was representing the heart of the person, wasn't it? Have you ever noticed that the ground that did not produce relates to wilderness? Read that parable again and see where the seed fell that did not give any fruit. See why. If you look at it, it's because it was a wilderness ground. Simple little things in the word, huh? But then you have the one that fell on good ground. It wasn't wilderness ground. And it gave forth what? Fruit. And in that parable, we have the complete explanation of why some fall real quick, some after a while, and why some are fruitful. It's talking about a wilderness situation. It's not fertile ground. The wilderness is not fertile what? Ground. Did you get that? Okay, so you have to conquer your wilderness. When you conquer your wilderness, then you're ready to enter into the promised land. Notice that the generation that did not conquer the wilderness died in the wilderness. But then the new generation conquered the wilderness, and then they are the ones that entered into what? The promised land. All of these things are shadows of our salvation. You come out of Egypt, the blood of the Lamb is put over the, you know, doorpost and so forth, salvation. And then you go into the wilderness. Now, what was the reason for going in the wilderness? A lot of people, they'll talk about this and they'll go, well, they left Egypt, go to the promised land. No, they didn't. They left Egypt to go to the wilderness to meet God on the mount. Before Moses went to Egypt, the Lord said, go, tell Pharaoh, let my people go. And then he said, and take them right to the promised land. Is that what God said? No. You know what he said? Bring them to this mountain that they might worship me. The only way that you will conquer your wilderness will be to find the mountain of God in the wilderness. Because in the wilderness is when the whole mount, that mountain, imagine on fire, and God spoke to his people in an audible voice. in the wilderness, in the mount. He didn't do it in the promised land. He did it where? In the mount. Where did he give him the Ten Commandments? In the wilderness. Did you get that? So we must conquer the wilderness. Amen? I could just sit here and tell you about a cute little sermon. I can come up with a cute little sermon and, you know, be everybody friendly. You don't ever have to go through anything in your life and, you know, bullfrogs and butterflies. But we are here to please God, and we're here to do what he wants us to do, and we want the whole counsel of God. So are you ready? We already taught on the beginning, but we're going to cover one verse, Luke 4:3. You have it in your paperwork. Do you guys have your sheets? Everybody have your sheets? Okay, look at Luke 4:3. And the devil said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, command this stone that it be made bread. Notice it says stone, one. We're not going to get into all the details, but basically he was attacking his sonship. The first temptation that you will face will be your sonship while you're in need. Your sonship while you're in need. You become a born-again Christian, you give your life to Jesus, and then all of a sudden, are you really saved? Is the Lord really going to provide for you? Here was mine, and all of ours are different. Here was mine. I was used to carrying a weapon all the time. I slept with a weapon underneath the pillow, and then I slept with a fully automatic machine gun loaded, ready to go next to my bed. Those were my teddy bears. It would comfort me. As soon as I got saved, God said, nah. You got to trust me. And I had to take my weapons, and I got rid of all my weapons. I do have some weapons now, but first I had to not trust weapons. And I had an argument with the Lord. I told him, don't you know that what I did here and this, that, and you know about that one situation and this and that. God, in case you didn't know, these people would like to kill me. Like he didn't know. Didn't change God's mind at all. And then the devil came. Are you ready? Are you really a son of God? Do you really believe that? Are you really born again? I mean, look at the way you trust that weapon. You depend on that weapon for your life. How can you be a son of God when you have entrusted your life to a weapon? Did you get that? Others, it might be a different way. You're not really saved. Look what you just did. Most people come to Jesus when they're at their wits' end. Some do not. Praise God for them. But most are going through horrendous things. Why? Because you find yourself needing him to be your father. Did you get it? But look at how Jesus deals with this. Luke 4:4. And Jesus answered him saying, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, by the superficial things, but by every word of God. Now, I don't know if you were here when we taught on this, but we need to cover this point. But by every word that God has spoken, he spoke for you. So you would have every word, the same one that spoke the heavens and the earth into existence. Every word that God has ever spoken is for you. The whole deal. Grab your Bibles and use it like a mouth. Every word. The mouth of God. So every word that God has spoken, Jesus said, is for you. Turn to your neighbor and say, you got the whole deal, baby. You have the same words when there was a rebellion in heaven, and God said to his top general, I don't want to dirty my hands. Go take care of my light work, please. You have angels that will assist you. Why? Because God spoke it. He's given his angels charge over thee, hasn't he? So, every word that God has spoken is for you to be able to live real life. All right, so now we're going to go to our second point. So turn to your neighbor and say, every word is mine. He spoke it for me so I could speak it to the devil, to circumstances. Hallelujah. Next verse. And the devil taketh him up into a high mountain. Now, I want you to understand that they were out in the wilderness. But Jesus is dealing with the top demonic powers. And Jesus is literally translated from the wilderness to a mountaintop physically. He's out in the wilderness. He gets attacked with the first temptation. He whoops the devil. And the devil physically translates him to another place. Now, I'm going to share this with you. I hope some of you do not faint, but I've been translated physically from one place to another. It's in the New Testament, oh, by the way, in another place where God does it. Remember the Ethiopian that was on the chariot and he couldn't understand the book of Isaiah? God sent a man, ministered to him. There was water. The man from Ethiopia said, hey, there's water right there. Baptize me. The Bible says that as soon as that man was baptized and he came up out of the water, the person that baptized him disappeared, was translated, and appeared in another part of the country. That's in the Word. That's in the Word. Everything the devil knows, he's learned from God. But whether, you know, people are ready for this or not, I've been translated from one. I'm not trying to be a big shot or anything. I'm just telling you that it happened. I was in one place, I was translated to the other. Physically. Me and my wife know this one lady. She was very close to us. She was in San Diego at their church. She was praying. I'm talking about God doing it. In the church, she was physically translated to Russia. It was snowing. There was a group of Russian believers that were praying to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. She was materialized in Russia. She ministered to them on the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They all received the Holy Spirit. She was translated back to San Diego. When she appeared in San Diego, she had snow on her. She brought some snow back. A friend of mine, Reverend Glenn Wilson, invited her to go and preach in London. She went to London. The Lord told her, when you go to London, get the same clothes that you were wearing when you were translated to Russia. And I want you to wear them on the first night that you minister. She did so. A little Russian lady came in through the back door, and she started screaming, interrupted the service. And she said, "It's the lady that came from the sky." That's her. They had escaped. And Reverend Wilson told me, that is a true story. We can all believe it for real now. We are heading into fabulous times. You'd be surprised what God will do to get the gospel somewhere. Ezekiel, have you ever read about Ezekiel? How the Lord would just grab him and translate him and put him somewhere else? But this time, it was a counterfeit. And the devil, taking him up into a high mountain, showed him in all the kingdoms of the world in a moment's time. Did you get that? Physically took him to a mountaintop, and spiritually at the same time showed him all the kingdoms of the world. After you go through your wilderness experience, you'll be ready to go to the promised land. But listen to this. He has already tempted him when Jesus had nothing. He didn't even have food in his stomach. Say that's nothing. Now it's not food. It's not meeting his need. Now it's making him great. You have nothing. I'm going to make you great. After I got saved, I had a debt I had to pay. Well, I was no longer a drug dealer, and God had told me not to touch the money, to leave the money out on the street. Don't touch it. Whatever money I had that had to do with the drug business, I could not touch. The drugs that I had, I could not sell. That had to be flushed on the toilet. I had 36 cents in my pocket and a hungry Doberman pincher. Did you get that? I went through my first temptations. All of a sudden, I had to pay this substantial bill. And all of a sudden, here comes one of my old friends. And he said, you know, Jose, just take me to meet your the owner of the factory. Says, you don't have to have, all you have to do is just take me to him and introduce me and walk away. I pay for the plane there, the plane back. You don't have to sell anything. And it's going to shock you. Guess how much money he offered me? Exactly what my debt was. It shocked me. Exactly. Because it wasn't an even number. The devil knew my need, but so did God. And I looked at him and I said, Lewis, I can't do it. What do you mean you can't do it? You're a Christian. You're not going to be dealing anything. You're out of this lifestyle. What are you going to do is take me to introduce a man so I can just shake his hand. And I said, I can't. I mean, Jose, you could be back up on your feet again. You can avoid all of this trusting God stuff. I mean, just avoid it. Here's the money. And that's just the way it is. We have so many people that are backslid outside the church, and then you have the backsliders in the church. We're in Las Vegas. Can I just be plain with you? Just blunt. Me and my wife went to eat at this hotel. All of a sudden, a lady walks up to us, and she has a G-string on. I didn't even know that cocktail waitresses wore a G-string there. But it was a sister in the Lord that I knew. Does everybody know what a G-string is? It is a line that goes in between your buttocks. And we're not even going to talk about the upper part of the... And she told me how this was okay because her pastor said she had a ministry there. Your pastor better get right or he's going to split hell wide open. Is that blunt enough for everybody? She was a good tither, you know. When you're a good-looking woman and you wear a G-string. And she wasn't a baby Christian. She had been a Christian for many, many years. So she wasn't getting out of something. But she had been taught that this is okay. She has a ministry. Someone's going to have to answer for this. And that's why there's Jesus mention about some will say, didn't we do this in your name? Do that in your name. And he said, I never knew you. Depart from me. But see, we're in Las Vegas. This is hardcore territory. Hardcore territory. I really believe that a lot of people don't even believe that we're in warfare. I doubt if a lot of people even believe there's a hell, but I can assure you that there is, because God took me to heaven, and if there's a heaven, there's also a hell, because when I was there, he talked to me a little bit about the other side. But of course, I could just be some crazy religious fanatic. But when we all stand in front of God, we're going to see if there's a heaven or a hell. The enemy is a deceiver. On the other hand, we had a woman that was a stripper. She came to church for 5 months. I knew she was a stripper because she told me. She had a little boy. Cute little boy. Every Sunday morning he would come and shake my hand. I didn't mind her coming to church. She was thinking about giving her life to Jesus. You want to know why for 5 months she came to church, and then on the fifth month she gave her life to Jesus? Because she had been counting the price, and she had been doing things to get out of her lifestyle. And as soon as she got her little certificate and she was able to get her new job, she came up and gave her heart to Jesus. Should we allow that to happen in my Father's house? Yes. A million times yes. Because she was counting the price. She never claimed to be a Christian. I mean, can you imagine a woman comes up to you and goes, I'm a stripper. Is it okay if I come to church? But I'm not a Christian. I have not given my heart to Jesus. Do you think it would be okay to let her come to church? She wasn't tempting any man. She wasn't. As a matter of fact, she acted more properly than some of the self-righteous hypocrites that were coming to the church at that time. Then I had a woman come to me and say, did you know that this woman is a stripper? She's been coming here for many months. And I said, I sure do. She says, well, aren't you going to talk with her and ask her to leave? And I said, no. As a matter of fact, it doesn't look like you fit in this church. You want to know why? I knew that that woman was going to talk bad about her. And I would see the little boy every Sunday come and shake my hand. On the fifth month, she gave her heart to Jesus. She says, I got a little certificate and now I'm working. And I'm making just enough money to keep me and my son. Alive. It's a war. And we're the winners. But it is a war. I just thought I'd entertain you with one of my Las Vegas stories. But we're in Las Vegas. We're not in the Bible Belt. Turn to your neighbor and say, you must be one bad mama jama. Forgot to put you here. You must be something else. Forgot to drop you in the middle of this place. God must love this place to put you here. He does. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Translated him. Say, that's some serious principality and power. Taking him up into a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment. Next verse. And the devil said unto him, all this power. Now notice that he showed him what? Kingdom. It was the devil's kingdom. They were kingdoms, but they were the devil's what? Kingdom. Who had given them to him? Men. He worked together with men and built these kingdoms. Men had given them to him. Did you understand that? Don't you ever say God gave them these kingdoms. It was men. After the fall, you know what David said? The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, and everyone that dwells in it. The Bible says that the cattle on a thousand hills belong to the Lord, and the gold and everything else. God never gave the deed to the planet to the devil. Hallelujah. But that's a whole different theological matter. Now notice that in verse Luke 4, 5, he says, all the kingdoms of the world. Now notice the next verse, that the devil continues, and the devil said unto him, all this power will I give thee, and the glory of them. I don't know if you caught the three words there. What's the beginning of the Lord's Prayer? Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Are you ready? Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And then you get to the bottom and you know what it says? For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Guess what was going on here? Kingdom, power, and glory. It's no coincidence. Look at the two verses. Let's read them together. And the devil taketh him unto a mountain, a high mountain, showed him unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said unto him, all the power will I give thee and the glory. Now you get to the point where he couldn't buy you with some cheap trinket. Now he's going to offer you kingdom, power, and glory. Did you get that? Just like the Lord's Prayer. Why? Because what he does is he takes spiritual truth and he has built his kingdom upon spiritual truth, except he's perverted them. But he operates under the same principles. Kingdom, power, glory. Is that settling into you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For that is delivered unto me, and to whomsoever I will give it. It had been delivered to him by men. What kingdoms was he offering him? Do you know that Jesus was just offered the Roman Empire to be Caesar? He was just offered to be Caesared. That was the top kingdom on the planet at that time. Don't look so surprised. There's been some that have been offered political positions for their soul. And they certainly do not have the care of the people. Thank God it looks like America's in a turnaround now. Hallelujah. Kingdom, power, glory. You've already been given a kingdom. You've already been given power. And you've already been given the glory of God. It came upon you when the blood of Jesus Christ washed you white as snow. don't trade your kingdom. How many of you know that Jesus came to bring the kingdom? What did he tell the disciples? Tell them that the kingdom of God is at hand. You know what that means? That you can reach out and grab it with your hand. That's how close. Turn to your neighbor and say, you already have the kingdom. And you certainly have the power. Hallelujah. And we give him the glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Why am I sharing about the three temptations in the wilderness? Because God is saying, teach my children how to drive the devil out of the wilderness. Who departed from the wilderness? Jesus or the devil? Who left first? He drove him out of his wilderness. Whatever you're going through right now, God has led you there so you can conquer that wilderness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. If thou therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. I will make this clear. When you go for his kingdom, you're worshiping him. There is no, somebody might come up and say, well, I've never gotten on my knees and worshiped Satan. Oh, yeah, you did. As soon as you sold out and you put money, power, and you being glorified, you bow down in your heart and you worship him. You just became a Satan worshiper. I just wanted to make that real clear. Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Anything in between is sin. So I wouldn't want to sin from behind the pulpit. How do I know? I did it. Came from Cuba. We had nothing. Just to have stuff to eat and so forth. I sold out there. Then I wanted a kingdom, and I wanted power, and I wanted people to admire me. And that's why I got into the drug business. It was a kingdom. You had your subjects, the people that sold the drugs for you. You had your higher-ups, but you were the king. That was the kingdom. And then the power. Then the power. To walk into a place and know that people will not mess with you because they're scared of you. You don't pay your drug money in time, you're going to get hurt. Somebody else is going to hurt you. One of the soldiers of your kingdom. Oh, and then the glory. To walk into places and oh, there's a big shot. A big shot that couldn't even go to sleep at night. That had to have an attack dog running around the house before he went to sleep. I had to take all the doors of the house, and all the doors were open so the dog could get, the dog could get to every room. And the dog could wake me up so I would have enough time to grab a hold of my weapon. How'd you like to live like that? Not thinking, but knowing that people want to kill you. Not, I'm suspicious that somebody might be after me. No. You know. There's no rest for the wicked. and I sold out for a kingdom, for a new car, for money in my pocket. I sold my soul. But I want you to know that the blood of Jesus, and God is so powerful that he can break any covenant that anybody's ever made with the devil. The Bible says that we've been translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. Translated. Did you get it? Translated. The devil learned that from the Lord, translating somebody to a high place. Well, guess what? Not the copy, but you got the real deal. You've been translated to the kingdom of God in the high mountain of God. The real mountain. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm not proud that I've experienced such darkness in my life, but I'm just telling you that Jesus is the deliverer. He's the deliverer. He has healed the brokenhearted, open wide the prison doors. He is able to deliver evermore. His name is Jesus, Jesus. Sad hearts weep no more. I was possessed, and when Jesus came, they had to leave. They didn't even argue, they just left. All hail, King Jesus. If thou therefore will worship me, all shall be thine. The first one was this. Every word that God has spoken that's proceeded out of the mouth of God, hallelujah, every word is yours. In Jesus' name. Speak God's word. Hallelujah. Now we're on the second one. And Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan. In other words, get out of my way. For it is written, are you ready? Notice that Jesus has answered him back with the word. He'll answer him with the word three times. Do you know how many times Satan came to Jesus with the word? One time. Not all three. Did you understand that? It's the last temptation that he came and tried to twist the word of God. The first two, it wasn't. He wasn't quoting scriptures. He was using the principles of the kingdoms twisted. But he did not quote a direct scripture till we come to the last temptation. Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou worship. You know what Jesus just told him? Worship God. I don't know if you know this, but do you know that one of his names in the Old Testament is called the Lord of Hosts? Do you know what that means? The Lord of all the hosts. That includes a satanic, the horrific satanic kingdom. That's why that is such a powerful name. The Lord of Hosts, good and bad. He's the Lord of them all. I love that song. His name is Jesus, Jesus. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, Watch this. Thou shall worship the Lord thy God. Not just me, but I'm bringing it to you. Thou shall worship the Lord thy God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And him only shall thou serve. Do you know that the devil is serving God? Why do you think that the Bible says that the Father talks about God and says that he'll not allow you to be tempted above that which you can what? Stand. Well, if he will not allow you to be tempted above what you can stand, it must mean that he has control of the devil. It must mean that he has a choke collar on him like you have on your dog. Because if God would allow him, did he have to go to God to get permission to mess with Job? So who's in control? Have you guys ever heard of a dumbbell? It's to what? To build muscles, make you stronger. The devil is God's dumbbell. So you can develop. The Bible says, whatever is born of God overcometh the world. That's the whole world, by the way. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Our faith in what? That God is who he is. If you want to be a great woman of God, a great man of God, you're going to have to believe how great God is. The best thing about spending time with God is you get to be like him. You know, birds of a feather flock together. You spend time with God and see if you don't come out thinking like Jesus. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. How many of you know that Jesus is intensifying the blows? Oh, you want another scripture? You know what? You know what the Word of God says? You believe in God, thou thus well. The devil also believe and tremble. Now, they believe in God and they tremble. What does that mean? He's in control. We're going to be talking about the original plan of God in the future. I want you to listen closely. To have a free will, you have to be able to choose. That's why the devil was created. With no choice, you have no free will. The reason the devil was made is because he's the opposite of God. Do you believe that God knew what the devil was going to become before he did? And he made him anyway. Why? Because God was making. He made the devil. He made all of the angels. He knew the devil was going to do what he did before he did it. Made the devil with a free will. Got it? Do you know the angels have a free will? Do you know why one third of the angels fell? They have a free will too. Do you think it's just us that we're tested? Whether we're going to follow God or not, whether we love him or evil? The angels went through the same thing we're going through right now. That's why one third fell, because they had a free will. There is a plan for your free will. Did you catch that? I didn't say you. I'm getting intimate now. There's a plan for your free will. Your free will is so powerful. But there is a plan for your free will. Your will is in your soul. There's a plan for your soul. Well, let's get back on this. He gave us the opposite. And God said, now they have the opposite of me. Now they can exercise the free will. Whew. Now the next one is when it really gets tricky. Let me see. Just for bare necessities is the first one. The second one is kingdom, power, and glory. You know what the third one is? The kingdom of religion. Because now he takes him what? To church. The temple. You know that some people are brought to church by the devil? Oh my goodness, Pastor Jose. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a what? Pinnacle of the temple. Took him to church. Now, isn't that crazy? Took him to church. Remember, bare necessities, kingdom, power, and glory, and now? We're going to church. Anybody remember the Dark Ages? Anybody ever read about Christians being burned alive by supposedly Christians? That happened in the church kingdom. Who was really behind the crucifixion of Jesus? It wasn't somebody that needed to eat a hot dog because he was starving to death. And it wasn't the Roman Empire. You know who it was? The third level. It was a religious kingdom. They were responsible. The Romans were just the instrument, but they put the hit out. They wrote the contract. The religious kingdom. Say, it's getting interesting. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from hence. He went back on the first point. Are you the Son of God? Are you a son of God? But this time it's not from, are you the Son of God, if you can make a loaf of bread or a hot dog out of the wilderness. But this time, he's coming at him from a whole different angle. Spiritual pride. If you're the Son of God, nothing can happen to you. Have you ever seen a Christian that is so proud that anything can happen to anybody else, but not me? I'm so called, I'm so anointed. I'm such a great man of God. One such person came to Jesus and said, I fast 3 times a week. I give tithes, offerings, and everything. Oh, and by the way, God, I have to thank you that I'm not like this guy. And Jesus said this, which one of them left that was right with God? Which one? Took him to the biggest ministry, the temple at Jerusalem. He could have taken him to a synagogue somewhere else, you know. But notice what he picked. The religious kingdom. And he brought him to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down. If you are the Son of God, nothing can happen. No matter what you do, you're protected. If you're the Son of God. For it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee. This is when he quotes a verse in the last temptation. Why? Because he's in the religion kingdom. And in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy what? Foot against a stone. Why would he use that? I mean, the very end of the scripture tells you, unless you what? You dash your foot against what? A stone. Because he was sucking him in. Trying to suck him in to, even if you do dash your foot against a stone, nothing will happen to you. Why? Because you are the Son of God. If you are. If you're the Christ. He was dealing with the Christ. Do you know that Christ could have dashed his foot against a stone? What he was trying to get him to do. Now, let me give you a lesson on dashing your foot against a stone. Remember Samson? You know what he said after his head hair was cut off to Delilah and to himself? Well, I'll just shake them off of myself like I did before. You know what the next verse says? And he knew not that the Spirit of the Lord had departed from him. He dashed his foot against a stone. But here's the best part. Remember when they burned his eyes out? You know what the very next verse says? And his hair began to grow. That's my favorite verse in that story. They burned his eyes out, and the next verse, and his hair began to grow. Samson, if you're here, if you're watching over the internet, your hair is growing. Your hair is growing. Your hair is growing. as you've been listening, your hair has been growing. Now get ready for the best part. And Jesus answered and said unto him, it is written, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy what? Thy God. What did people call Jesus? Lord. That means master. Do you know what Jesus was saying? The gloves came off. Jesus was saying, you will not tempt the Lord your God. Either Jesus was God or he wasn't. And if he was God in the flesh, then he was talking about himself when he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. You know what Jesus was really saying? Man's not going to live by bread alone, including this one right here. I call Jesus the God-man. God had the body of a man. That made him the God-man. And he said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that's coming out of this mouth right here in front of you. But by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. All right, now get ready for this. And Jesus answered and said unto him, It is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. The secret there is thy. The secret is that little word, thy God. Thy God. And I want you to notice that all of this happened after a 40-day fast. It doesn't say Satan tempted him during the 40 days with these three temptations. It said that the fast had come to an end, and then he hungered, and then the devil came. Woo, you got the victory. You did the 40-day thing. Look at the first verse. That's what it says. It says it was over. My God, Jesus, are you ready? And Jesus, being full of the Spirit, was what? Returned from Jordan, and he was led by the Spirit unto what? The wilderness. Being 40 days tempted of the devil, and in those days he did eat nothing, and when they were what? Ended. When you fast, guard yourself right after the fast. Because, you're at the top of your game. 40 days. Man, you something, ain't you? All right, we're going to finish. Do not tempt the Lord thy God. And when the devil had ended all the temptations, do you know what that means? His entire arsenal, he had ended. He had nothing left. And when the devil had ended all the temptation, notice how it says the temptation, not temptations. It was a plan. It was all a part of a singular plan. He departed from him for a season. I want you to say this with me. He kicked him out of the wilderness. Jesus was led of the Spirit to kick the devil out of the wilderness. Next verse. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit into Galilee, and there went out a fame of him throughout all the region round about. When you deal with this, when you conquer the wilderness, you will go forth in the power of the Spirit. And the best part is that people are going to know about Jesus. His fame will grow. His fame will grow. Now, you know the word ended? And when the devil had ended, you know what the word ended means there? To end. Completely. Bring to an end. Jesus had taken care of him completely, and he had brought the one that could translate a man's body from one place to another physically, had brought him to an end. He had brought his power to an end in the wilderness in Jesus' life. And he did this for you and me. So you, turn to your neighbor and say, you could bring it to an end. Who brought the temptations to an end? Jesus. Guess who brings the temptations to an end in your life? And you. You have the say-so when the temptation ends.
Hallelujah.
It is your free will. And you have the power in your will because Jesus put it there. He just told us how. And you can have the final word and say, my will says this comes to an end now. You have no power over me. I'm a son or a daughter of the living God. So the word there ended to end completely, bring to an end, finish, complete. It was a complete victory. Now, the word temptation, it putting to proof by experiment of good. To put to proof by an experiment of what? Of good. Experience of evil. Huh. Like an experiment of good and an experience of what? Evil. I don't know if you got it. Satan was running an experiment on God, and the results weren't too good. It was an experiment against good. He should have learned from Job. He experimented with a man that God said, this guy loves me. Turn to your neighbor and say, how's your experiment going? See, because what the devil does is he comes and he has an experiment and goes, I wonder if they really believe that they are sons of God. You have the say-so in the end of the experiment. Jesus ended it. And now that you have the titles of sons and daughters of God, you have the authority to have the last word. You women should have no problem with that one. To putting to proof by experiment of good. experience of evil. Solicitation. Discipline or provocation. By implication, what? Adversity. Do you think without Jesus I could have ever quit my addiction of cocaine? But when he came, he gave me the power to bring an end to that temptation. He put something in my free will that I could will and say, I will that this comes to an end right now, and I will never snort coke again. That is the power. Jesus has given you the power to will. In your will, you have the power to stop things. Right. And to start things. And to create things. So there we have it. Put an end to it, and the devil had to leave the wilderness. Now we're going to pray, hallelujah, for the power of God to come upon you, and that the reality is going to possess you. See, the Holy Spirit possesses people. That's why you can do things that you couldn't do before. That's why you can resist things you couldn't resist before, because you're possessed. The Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You know what that means? You have multiple personalities. If somebody else is living in you besides you, that means somebody else is in you. You know what Paul said? Know ye not that ye are the temple of the Holy Spirit, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? Paul's main ministry was teaching people how to be possessed by the Holy Spirit. Greater is he that is in me. He that is in the world. So how we're going to activate this is by asking the Holy Spirit to possess us. How do you exercise your free will in the most radical way? Let me share it with you. I plead the blood of Jesus over me now. I plead the blood of Jesus over my body, soul, and spirit. I plead the blood of Jesus over my free will right now. Thank you, Father, for my free will. And now I will to be possessed by the Holy Spirit. When you walk in the Spirit, it means you're possessed by the Spirit. When you have spiritual ears, and you have spiritual insight, they're the gifts of who? The Spirit. And the Spirit is in you. So you're possessed by the Spirit, so if they're his gifts, then the one that possesses you uses his gifts through you. Are you ready to ask God in Jesus' name through the blood to possess you? Are you ready to let God possess you? That's the only way you're going to be able to be victorious. It's not by power nor by might, but by my that means you have to be possessed. This is not so much as keeping rules as it is being possessed by the one that can keep the rules. Now, do you really believe that the Holy Spirit can possess you? I mean, if I were to take a goat and do a pentagram right here and kill it in front of you and say, now everybody come and be possessed. You know that if we're not careful, we'll have more faith in that possession that we will in asking the Holy Spirit through the blood of Jesus to possess us? Oh, I'll give it to you another way. If somebody were to stand up right now and start cussing the most horrible cuss words in the middle of the church right now, no one would have a problem believing that God is upset with that person. We might even part so the bolt of lightning doesn't hit you. God heard it. No doubt about it. But if we go to pray, we have a hard time believing that God heard us. Your free will ties into all of that too. So, are we ready? You're going to mean it. You're talking to God. You're not talking with Jose. We're going to heaven, heavenly places. Amen? Now, we're going to pray a blessing over you. It is the only blessing that God, okay, dictated to be poured upon the children of Israel. In other words, to be prayed over the children of Israel. You have blessings, but this is a particular blessing where God said, now you will do this. And I'll bless them. It is the only time in the Bible where God literally says, writes out the prayer for them to pray over his people. In other places it talks about do this, do that, but this is a blessing. Okay, when you go into the Hebrew, you really see that this is different than anything else. So I'm going to pray that blessing over you, and then you're going to ask the Holy Spirit to possess you. Amen? The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Notice that all three points start out with the Lord. Do you know that that is his signature? That means the self-existing one. The self-existing one. The self-existing one. Three times his name is brought up, Jehovah. Then he ends like this. And they shall put my name upon the children of Israel. Why? He just prayed his name three times. The Lord said, in these three areas, put my name in their life. And they shall put my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. Why? Because the name of God has been put upon them. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And they shall put, and we have, your name upon them, Lord God. And you said you would bless your people. The presence of God is here. Now we're going to ask him to possess us. Let's say this together. Are you ready? As a matter of fact, let's stand in his presence. If you want, stay, you know, you can stay sitting down. You don't have to get up. If, you know, God will bless you sitting down. He sits on his throne, you know, and he exercises power through his throne, so you can sit down and his power is capable of touching you. Are you ready? Now you're going to ask the Holy Spirit to possess you in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of King Jesus, cover us with his blood. We plead the blood of Jesus over our body, soul, and spirit. We plead the blood over our free will. You gave it to us. We thank you for it. Now we will, we exercise the will you gave us. We want to be possessed by your mighty Holy Spirit. Possess me, Holy Spirit. Take over. Completely.
To us,
a son is given.